here, the worshipers! Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go.
Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, we're going to take a journey on trying to better understand the crisis that the elites have gotten Americans and people from around the world into trouble. I'm going to talk about the immigration issue and why this blame game is not going to help anyone except the private prison system, but it's not going to lessen the pain of those who've been suffering from being in countries that we have caused the civil destruction, and we're not granting them an easy opportunity to get into our country, and we're separating children from parents. But we're going to take a historical look at this, one that is measured and not hysterical or ideological. Also today, time permitting, isn't it time that we stop scapegoating Iran? Chris Hedges believes that. We're going to hear from Chris. And I was glad to see Michelle Obama and Ms. Bush, Laura Bush, and the other ex-president's wives speaking out about it's wrong to separate children from their parents. And indeed, they are correct. And I believe any person with a heart will realize the trauma that a child and the parent goes through when that occurs. And that's the end of it. I mean, let's move on. Almost. Not quite. I just have a little comment for all the ex-president's wives. I think you'll find just a few words I'm going to share on that to be of interest. But we always begin with the latest on health and healing. Bad habits, and that's like a bad diet, eating junk food, drinking coffee and alcohol, those French fries and pretzels and peanuts, and well, they lead to disease. Well, they first lead to inflammation, and then inflammation leads to disease. But according to Northwestern University, that those bad habits can lead to cancer and other chronic disease, but simply correcting your lifestyle, beginning to exercise, don't sit around and become sedentary, get up, go bicycling, go power walking, take a little breaks throughout the day and just to do some deep knee bends, sit-ups, things that get your musculature going, and then just more clean, healthy water in your body. It's your number one nutrient, water. 72% of your body's water. So it should be clean and healthy. And then fruits and vegetables. That can completely change everything. Now, that's the reality of it. We're just spending too much time engaged in social media, looking at screens. We're not getting enough exercise. We're eating a high-fat diet and low in fruits and vegetables. So they took a look what happens if you change that. And they found that the way people are living will absolutely lead to heart disease, common cancers, breast cancer, colon cancer, prostate cancer. But just doing the things that all the people in our health support groups and people go away and leave their cell phones at home and do a retreat, it reverses all this. It's not magic and it's not difficult. You see, but we live in a society that is very monotheistic. We are single-minded. Now, it's a spectrum, and a lot of this has to do with when you're young, the most important people in influencing your choices and what's real to you are your parents. They're everything to you. Now, if they're good parents, you learn some good lessons. And if they're not so good, then you're going to learn maladaptive lessons That's why some people today get into relationships where their friends and outside people say, that's an abusive relationship. Person said, no, it's not. No, the person's bad. Well, but, you know, he apologizes or she apologizes. They go right back to doing it. You can bet that somewhere in that person's background, they pick that up, that that's how they understand love. It's abusive. It's demeaning. It's degrading. It subverts all spiritual values. It creates a form of human bondage. So these are adaptive. And then after you get away from the parents, you become influenced by your peers. And then we start doing some things, almost always wrong, because what do young people know? They don't know anything. But they all want to seem like they're hip and aware and into it. And so we make more mistakes. And then we get into college, and what do they know in college today? Most people, there are some exceptions, but most people go to college for a career. Very few go to become critical thinkers. Now, when you get in the real world, the most powerful tool you can have is being a critical thinker. Going to neutral before you make a judgment. Staying unattached to the outcome. Looking at beyond what is in your face, the emotions that are in your face. The convincing, the conniving, the cajoling, the power plays. And simply take a step back and say, what am I really dealing with? What is this? And then seeing it for what it is, then knowing how to respond, how to disengage or engage, depending upon what the raison d'etre is, the meaning of. What do you mean by this? What is the meaning of this relationship? What is the meaning of my job? Is this just to make money? Why am I living here? A couple of years ago, I had one of the most interesting comments from a person I was interviewing who was homeless. And I said, why are you here, living near Miami Beach? He said, well, he said, I came from Buffalo. If you're poor and homeless, better to be poor and homeless where it's warm. Put every advantage to you. I'd rather be here at the beach so each morning I can go for a swim, come out and take a shower over there. So I'm getting my shower, I shampoo. There's a restroom there. So at least the beginning of my day is okay. Now, if I was in Buffalo, there wouldn't be any shower, there wouldn't be any beach, there wouldn't be any swimming, and you'd be spending the whole day figuring out how you're not going to freeze to death. So just imagine this. Imagine if each choice you made about your life was based upon an ideal, not what you had adapted to from your parents, teachers, or your other influencers. What choices would you make differently? So what they're saying here in the Journal of Medical and Internet Research, they're saying change your lifestyle and change all diseases. It's that simple. It's not complicated. Then we have a study from the Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine. They're a good group, by the way. And this was published in the peer-reviewed Journal of Clinical Nutrition. And they say, quote, plant-based diets, that's your vegan diet, improves glycemic control, that's your blood sugar, leading to weight loss and improved cholesterol in people with type 2 diabetes. Now, this was a review of 9 randomized controlled trials that assessed the effectiveness of vegan and vegetarian diets for diabetes patients. And the results show that those who ate a plant-based diet lowered their cholesterol, lost weight, lowered their HbA1c levels, and improved other cardiometabolic risk factors when compared to those who ate a non-vegetarian diet. How bad is it, though? Well, according to the latest figures, approximately 100 million Americans, that's a lot, that's about 26% of the American population, are pre-diabetic or diabetic. And many of the pre-diabetics don't even know that they're pre-diabetic. That means a greater risk of heart attacks, strokes, and cancers, and dementia. And those with diabetes are up to 400% more likely to die of cardiovascular disease than those who do not have diabetes. Quote, the link between diabetes and cardiovascular disease is strong. 60 to 70% of people who have type 2 diabetes die of heart disease. That's according to Dr. Hannah Kalalva, MD, PhD, Director of the Clinical Research of the Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine. So, a plant-based diet can make a big difference. Now, shortly when I return to New York, I'll be doing a health support group for diabetics and people with high blood pressure. There's a woman, she may be listening now. If you're the woman who was at the retreat and in April and you had uncontrolled blood sugar, your diabetes, and high blood pressure, even with all those medicines you were taking, and in 1 week you dropped 100 points off your blood sugar and your blood pressure came down to normal and you lost, I think, 16 pounds, we'd like to hear from you. Give us a call. 888-874-4888. I haven't spoken to her, but I'd like to hear how she's doing. I always have people that I'm hopeful will continue making positive choices, go back and see the improvements. And by the way, we have a gentleman, I don't have time today because we've got a packed show, but tomorrow I'm going to replay a person who has end-stage COPD, a major killer in America, lung disease, and end-stage leukemia. And instead of staying in hospice and dying, he decided I have nothing to lose, and he came to retreat. I didn't know he had any of this. And he has made such a major change that when he went last Thursday to visit his doctor, his primary care physician, the doctor said, I don't know what's going on here. You have no congestion. I can determine in your lungs. So surprised was his doctor that he sent him out to a separate pulmonologist to see if he could find anything, because he had never heard anyone reversing end-stage COPD. And this guy's feeling like $1 million. Oh, and he went out on the road and didn't stop till he had done 30 miles. I had to physically stop him. I had to grab him by the shoulders and say, friend, enough. He says, I can still go further. I said, I'm sure you can, but you've just done a 50K. You've done more than a marathon with two serious diseases. And he just had this big smile. Energy galore, no pain, and now he is, from what I understand, he is doing terrific. So he's going to get his pulmonologist report, and I've asked him to call us on there and tell us what that report says. And his leukemia, his white blood cells, tremendous drop, which is good. So he's getting that double-checked also. Now, from Harvard University, a higher level of vitamin D is needed for colorectal cancer protection. This was published in the Journal of the National Cancer Institute. And these were reportings of findings at the American Cancer Society and Harvard University and U.S. National Cancer Institute's other organizations that vitamin D is directly connected to colorectal cancer. The more you have, the less cancer you get. Quote, to address inconsistencies in prior studies on vitamin D and to investigate associations in population subgroups, we analyzed participant-level data collected before colorectal cancer diagnosis from 17 prospective cohort studies and used standardized criteria, noted co-senior author. The study looked at 5,700 individuals diagnosed with colorectal cancer and 7,100 control subjects in Asia, the United States, and Europe. And what they found was when you have more vitamin D, you have less colorectal cancer. It's that simple. That simple. And finally, everyone's using these antibacterial soaps. I do not recommend ever using an antibacterial soap. They're also using antibacterial toothpaste. This is from the University of Queensland, and it is saying that a common ingredient in toothpaste and hand wash could be contributing to antibiotic resistance. study was focused on triclosan, which is a compound used in more than 2,000 personal care products. So check your products in your bathroom. Let me spell it for you. Tri, T-R-I, Closan, C-L-O-S-A-N. Don't use the product. Quote, this is from Dr. Goa. He said, it is well known the overuse of misuse of antibiotics could create superbugs, meaning antibiotic-resistant bacteria. And now we're saying that one of the ways that we're getting this antibiotic resistance is by using all of these soaps because the chemical ends up in our body. And that is not good. And that can create all kinds of problems with our immune system. And by the way, antimicrobial resistance has become a major threat to public health globally, and about 700,000 people a year dying because they get the bacteria and no antibiotics work for them. So that's important. One last thing from the University of Iceland. Having stress-related disorder is associated with an increased risk of developing autoimmune disease. The bottom line is this. Stress-related disorders brought on by traumatic or stressful life events are associated with a higher risk of developing autoimmune disease. And you're talking about a lot of individuals are stressed. And think of all the vets coming back from Vietnam, the Korean War, and Afghanistan, Iraq. These individuals, every single one that was in combat, brought back some form of stress and trauma. That lowers the immune system, that in turn makes them more susceptible to diseases. So we should have a full program for previous people who've been into combat and current ones getting out, that we should rebuild their immune system. And there's ways of doing it. We've done it many, many times to help people with post-traumatic stress disorder. And one of the best things is to be around animals. Animals can give a lot of unconditional love and attention to someone. In fact, there are a lot of animal sanctuaries that invite vets or people who've had post-traumatic stress disorder to come in, and there's even a wolf sanctuary. And what's interesting in this wolf sanctuary is that the wolves will go to the person that is in most in need, and they sense it. They have that sense. They can pick up and read it. Other animals can do the same. They sense that you need help, and they're there to give you love. And we should have those in every community in the United States. Centers, you know, some doesn't take a lot of time or money or effort, where people can go who need help, at least as part of their overall therapy. There's certainly other therapies available. And we should also be opening up more of what Dr. Grayson has as energy-releasing tapping therapies. I've seen that work on vets to release their trauma. We should have those around the United States. Little oasis of healing. We're going to take a break and we'll be right back. Please stay with us. I'd like to welcome all of you from all over the world. I'm also encouraging you to go to prn.fm. You'll see a series of articles These are original, in-depth, very objective investigative reporting articles, fully referenced, fully vetted for accuracy, footnoted. And they show that there's a group of people with incredible power behind Wikipedia. There's also ones behind Facebook and Google. One at a time, we're taking our issues to Google and the people over there. And if you read the article, and we quote verbatim these skeptics who are part of, where they're the only people really who have the power to change inaccuracies or false statements and apply proper ones. But they're not allowing that to happen on the, and for acupuncture, homeopathy, chiropractic, herbs, anything involving holistic medicine. They're all down on it, not up on any of it. And all the people who've been attacked, from Rupert Sheldrake, one of the smartest men in history, and even Deepak Chopra, you can't, nothing you do will get it changed. Even Cheryl Atkinson saw this and reported on a recent TED conference speech. But no one's taken them on, as if they're too big, too powerful. Jimmy Wells, okay, we are. We're taking him on. We're taking him on because here's the story that's not being told. Think of what happens if someone really needs help, and there's a holistic modality that could help them alleviate, improve, or even reverse their disease. But if they go to Wikipedia and Google it, they're going to see, oh, this is all quackery, there's no science, there's no benefit. And then what if they decide not to go any further and just use standard treatment? What if they had depression or anxiety and end up with antidepressive medication or antipsychotic medication and commit suicide? It happens all the time. So you're deprived of what can work, and you're, in effect, led with very few options except the monotheistic, this is it, there's nothing else, don't trust anyone else, we're the guardians of the light of orthodoxy. So we're challenging them every week. The next one will be a powerful one that we'll be presenting next coming Monday, both in oral form as a program that you can download. So educate yourself, because the only way that you're going to be healthier and better in life is to know more of the facts that can help you. And then share this information, share the articles, share the information, and challenge Wikipedia, challenge Jimmy Wells, the owner. Let him know that, hey, Mr. Wells, if you're not aware that you have these people denying the benefits of homeopathy, chiropractic, vitamins, herbs, you know, massage therapy and body-mind therapies, and chelation, all, they deny everything. Have you done an investigation of their background? We have. Do you see how they have no objectivity? Yet your own bylaws say that you won't allow someone who has shown a bias to engage in using that bias on editing someone's script, and yet they do it every day. Why are you allowing this? How much of what they're doing and censoring represents your own personal views? And then how did you get those views? Who influenced you? Who's behind all this? I can only say that I know a lot more than what I'm saying now. This is going to be an extended effort. We're planning on at least 50 articles, a documentary, and other things I cannot tell you about. But needless to say, since I started this series, a lot of people are coming out of the woodwork, including whistleblowers. So you all see this in time, but educate yourself. Now, one of the things that's happening now is that people are aligned either on the left or the right, more often ideologically, which I believe is a big mistake. Just look for the truth. Don't moniker it with a title, because then you get into groupthink and I'm opposed to groupthink, you lose your sense of individual capacity to judge what is right or wrong. You get into that you're either with us or against us attitude. And how can you possibly learn anything from another person if you've denied any virtue in the other person at all? They're just the other to be demonized. What happens when we have no sense of intellectual or spiritual or emotional order in our life? Then we're going to be perpetually in conflict. All of the maladaptive and negative self-illusions are going to guide us. So I'm going to deal with this. And I'm just going to deal with this briefly today. But I see the entire problem as having a very simple solution. And it doesn't start with locking up and separating children. Even though if the children came with their parents to one of the designated entry points and sought asylum, that is not a crime and nobody would be locked up. They would just be verifying. Because what also is not being discussed is how many members of the organized crime families from South America are bringing in children where the person accompanying the adult is not their parent and they're abusing in the sex business. So what is the answer? Well, the first is to look carefully at the problem. And for those who think that this is all something brand new, it's not. Tell me who said this. I'd like to see if you know. Quote, "We've got to send a clear message that just because your child gets across the border, that doesn't mean your child gets to stay. We don't want to send a message that is contrary to our laws and encourages them to make the dangerous journey," end quote. Who said that? Telling people right up front, don't come if you're not doing it legally because we're not going to allow you to stay here. Who said that? If you know, give us a call right now, 888-874-4888. And before you think this is anything new, the people behind this were the Clintons. Then who were behind the Clintons? We know they're very tight with the private prison system. We have a lot of lawyers listening. I looked it up. Public Law 107-296, written and presented. It was passed in November 25th, 2002, 116 Stat 2205. Subtitle F, General Immigration Provisions. That's part of it. So it didn't just start. Now, I want to take a careful look at what maybe was not looked at by Laura Bush. I can't speak for her. She seemed like a very charm woman, and I'm sure that she was a good wife to her husband and a good mother to her children. And I'm also sure that she wanted the best for children everywhere. So when she made her statement, and then Michelle Obama made her statement, others made their statement, the statement itself, there's nothing to argue with. It's a legitimate statement. Children should not be separated from their parents. I agree. Deportation. Look at the National Immigration Law Center report. Differences largely due to, one, changes in immigration definitions, and two, the criterion variations in the militarization of federal agencies that strengthen deportation machine. Are you aware that Hillary and Bill Clinton had 12 million people between 1993 and 2000, detained or thrown out of the country? Bush, 10 million between 2001 and 2008. Obama, 5 million between 2009 and 2006. And keep in mind that there is no federal law that stipulates that children and parents be separated at the border, no matter how families enter the United States. But children that are separated because their parents tried to enter, or whoever was with them tried to enter illegally, can be held for 20 days. but it's the conditions under which they are held. It's the fact that we have not corrected any of the immigration problems whatsoever. So everybody just keeps kicking that ball down the road. And so to Mrs. Bush, I ask the following question. Did you have an issue with your husband permanently separating hundreds of thousands of families from their loved ones in the Middle East in a war that was based upon lies? Scientific America wrote an article, and they're very conservative on their statistics, that thousands of children died in Iraq because of your husband. Did you protest it? And by the way, the largest migration from an intact society occurred when Iraq had almost 12 million people who had to move because of sectarian violence and an awful lot of children. Also, I premiered a film down at the AMC Theater on 42nd Street because it was the largest one I could find in New York City. It was about 1,100 people showed up. And it was about film that I had done in Iraq. And there was a town of Fallujah. And doctors handed the film crew thousands of photographs of children born with birth defects because of depleted uranium being used. Children with cyclops heads, and just one eye in the middle of the head. Children born with no brains in the skull. It was so bad that all the doctors and nurses were encouraging people, don't get pregnant because there's a high probability you're going to end up with a deformed child. We showed at the end of the film about, I think it was around 50 of 5,000 photographs I had. That was 5,000 photographs from one hospital in Iraq. And when people in the theater, it was the very end, you could see them crying. You couldn't believe how bad it was because we showed the children not dead. We showed the children still alive, but with their defects and with their terminal cancers. And then how long they lived after that, weeks, months, all of them dead. Were there protests? If so, for the children who died because of your husband's war and Dick Cheney's war, and Dick Cheney's wife, Dick Cheney's daughter, have any of you taken responsibility for enabling someone or not standing up and saying what you're doing is wrong, I'm leaving? If it is, if you did, good for you. If you didn't, then maybe this should be one of those moments where we look internally. Bush's policies of, quote, invade the world, invite the world. Remember that? Caused huge amounts of human suffering, including in the United States. Interesting, back in 2001, when the war on terror started, Laura called it a fight to advance feminism in the Middle East. Quote, from you, Laura, a fight for the rights and dignity of women. Of course, that was under the Taliban. What exactly has changed in the last 17 years? Nothing. It's worse. And when your husband was negotiating and working with Saudi Arabia, what happened to the voices, your voice and others, when Saudi women were not given any rights whatsoever? None. That if a woman was raped, she could be put to death, but not her rapist. And if you were gay, you were killed. Frequently, double killed, because you were first killed. That's not an oxymoron. You were beheaded, then you were crucified. They still crucify people in Saudi Arabia, our ally. And then when they were funding terrorism, where were the protests? When they were denying children rights and women rights, where were the protests? No mention her husband was responsible for the Secure Communities program that started in 2002, which deputized police officers with immigration powers of enforcement, and this has led to the current anti-sanctuary legislation being passed in some states. And under Bush, the immigrant incarceration complex started by Clinton really boomed, with detention rising Bush turned to the private prison industry for help. And from a Texas Observer article, quote, the administration leaned on the private prison industry, which was more than happy to put up shoddy facilities, debt financed by local governments, and get paid for warehousing the tired and huddled masses. Texas was the epicenter of this new prison archipelago. For example, 2006, a former prison near Austin, run by Corrections Corporation of America, held undocumented families with infants and toddlers for months in conditions that human rights groups issue a lab from the Foundation Center called, quote, anti-family and un-American. I didn't see the left protesting that. Maybe I missed it. And no mention to Bush's NSEERS program to single out immigrants from 24 Muslim-majority nations for special interrogations and deportation. Obama did the same. Never outspoken about the George Bush's education policy, No Child Left Behind, that left hundreds of thousands of kids way behind. Utterly failed education program that for a while was the, quote, education of the land. And for Clinton to Bush to Obama and now Trump, the private prison system has divided numerous kids from mothers and families for minor illegal offenses such as drug possession. And here's something. The Democrats keep coming back to the Latino minority and African-American communities. If somehow it's your group, you're the ones who are going to defend them. You're pathological, all of you, who believe that anybody gives a about the fact that you're poor or struggling. But maybe, again, nothing more to see here, except that 7 million incarcerated people from Clinton to Trump, and most of those for minor drug offenses, where you go to jail for possession or use of a small amount of marijuana, 7 years, 12 years, 27 years. And what happens to your children? Put in foster care where frequently they've been outsourced for sex, abused, and nothing ever happens to that completely corrupt system. I'm doing a searing expose of all child services. From top to bottom, it is a cesspool of corruption and sexual abuse. In fact, I am so disgusted by it that on my Tonight Show, you don't want to miss Tonight's Show, man. You do not. You've never heard anything like this. You haven't nowhere. No one would have the courage to put on the stuff I'm going to put on tonight. I've got the top detective from Scotland Yard. I've got the top investigative journalist from the Times of London. I've got RT showing you that pedophilia is rampant, clear up to the highest member, the Prime Minister of England, pedophile. And this has gone on for 50 years. And never once have they been held accountable. But we all know, how did they get away with it? And in one particular area, 1,400 girls, 1,400 young girls they used. How they do it? How do you use 1,400 girls as sex slaves and no one notices or no one is held accountable? No one's arrested. Both of them worked on the same story, separate from each other. We're going to tell you a story you've never heard. It goes on in the United States as well, in Washington, D.C. So just remember, when you take a kid away from a parent because they use some drugs and you put him in jail, and we're not talking about 100 or 1,000, we're talking about at least 5 million. Because you got to figure 4 children per family, or 4 people per family, and you got 7 million people incarcerated, and if you got 50% of them for drugs, it's actually higher, then where's the outrage? There is none. And also, keep in mind that under George Bush, he doubled border security, $10.4 billion, 2007. He doubled the amount of patrol agents. And he stated in his speech that border walls will not be the cure. You bet it wasn't. Under Obama, well, right away he deported 3 million people. So how was he your friend? How was that a liberal policy? How was that humane? How was that decent or ethical? Where was the care for those people who could be returned to their home? And if they came because they were seriously in jeopardy of losing their life and they had no money and no resources and they went back to San Salvador, and if they were targeted and that's why they left, when they went back, they were killed. Who's taking responsibility for that? Also, as of 2013, over two-thirds of deportees were people caught within about 100 miles of the border, not sweeping hunts across cities in the United States now. In July 2014, Mother Jones' article, HS Health and Human Services, Office of Refugee Resettlement, 25,000 separated children across 80 different shelters during 2013. That was Obama. Where was the outcry? In 2014, an image leaked to CNN showed kids in cages. Under Bush, Border Patrol's budget went up and Obama doubled it. And he doubled the number of ICE agents. In fact, when Obama left, the budget was $20 billion, according to Pew Research. This is from the Texas Observer. Quote, perhaps the dingiest immigrant outpost in Bush and Obama's eras was the Willacy County Corrections Center, a.k.a. Tent City, in Raymondsville, composed of 10 Kevlar-covered steel frame buildings. The project was a $60 million no-bid affair that offered a little bit of government cheese to a number of prison industry rats. From the get-go, Tent City was a disaster. There were sexual abuses, maggots in foods, a tawdry corruption scandal that sent local officials to prison, and an appalling lack of access to medical care and attorneys. In 2015, after years of turmoil, the immigrants literally burned the place to the ground, definitive confirmation that the construction work was subpar, end quote. And under Clinton, he created the Illegal Immigration Reform and Immigrant Responsibility Act of 1996. He laid down the groundwork for the immigrant criminalization and deportation policies that we have today. And in 1997, the Supreme Court ruling stated illegal immigrant children and minors could not be held in detention centers like adults. Well, then everything they're doing is against the Supreme Court. Where are the lawsuits? Remember, the only difference today is that Trump is deporting even documented immigrants, hence the current exclusion and expulsion policy. Trump administration terminated the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals program, the DACA program, and according to Human Rights Watch, arrests of immigrants has risen 43% compared to what it was under Obama. Honduras, El Salvador, Haiti are also on the chopping block. Together, these countries, including Nicaragua, make up about 300,000 legal immigrants in the United States, but being targeted for deportation. All these countries have been lobbying to keep TPS status. Honduras is the world's highest murder rate, followed closely by El Salvador and Nicaragua. So we should be rethinking how we allow people into our country, and it should be based upon common sense and humanity. I will spend an hour on an upcoming program giving you what is a positive solution that will help the legal immigrants, that will help no more prisons for these people or detentions, and how to work with the countries where they're coming from so that there can be some order in the process, and how what you can do to allow those people who are here to become constructive members of societies without demonizing them. It's not that complicated, and it shouldn't be completely political. Oh, and by the way, for those who think that this was all caused by Donald Trump, and hence they've made it purely political, it wasn't. In the CNN town hall report that I gave you, we've got to send a clear message that just because your child gets here across the border, that doesn't mean your child gets to stay. That was Hillary Clinton. But don't take my word for it. You want to hear people saying the same thing verbatim because they have the same policy wonks? They have the same people that they're responsible to, the same people that help them with their campaigns, and therefore they're beholden to the people behind the scenes, the hidden states? I'm going to play you two clips right now. They're short clips. Clinton and Obama.
Not only in the states most heavily affected, but in every place in this country are rightly disturbed by the large numbers of illegal aliens entering our country. The jobs they hold might otherwise be held by citizens or legal immigrants. The public service they use impose burdens on our taxpayers. That's why our administration has moved aggressively to secure our borders more by hiring a record number of new border guards, by deporting twice as many criminal aliens as ever before, by cracking down on illegal hiring, by barring welfare benefits to illegal aliens. In the budget I will present to you, we will try to do more to speed the deportation of illegal aliens who are arrested for crimes, to better identify illegal aliens in the workplace, as recommended by the commission headed by former Congresswoman Barbara Jordan. We are a nation of immigrants, but we are also a nation of laws.
Even as we are a nation of immigrants, we're also a nation of laws. Undocumented workers broke our immigration laws, and I believe that they must be held accountable, especially those who may be dangerous. When I took office, I committed to fixing this broken immigration system, and I began by doing what I could to secure our borders. But today, our immigration system is broken, and everybody knows it. There are actions I have the legal authority to take as president. Tonight, I'm announcing those actions. We'll build on our progress at the border with additional resources for our law enforcement personnel so that they can stem the flow of illegal crossings and speed the return of those who do cross over. If you're a criminal, you'll be deported. If you plan to enter the U.S. illegally, your chances of getting caught and sent back just went up. We expect people who live in this country to play by the rules. We expect that those who cut the line will not be unfairly rewarded. The actions I'm taking are not only lawful, they're the kinds of actions taken by every single Republican president and every single Democratic president for the past half century. And to those members of Congress who question my authority to make our immigration system work better, question my authority, question my authority, question my authority, question my authority, or question the wisdom of me acting where Congress has failed, I have one answer. Pass a bill.
So you see, this problem did not just start. Both Democrats and Republicans are equally responsible for this mess. The trouble is the cynicism of trying to exploit people's weaknesses, fears, traumas to your advantage politically. This is what I do not like. I do not like seeing someone go on a program and now they're starting to say it's concentration camp, concentration camp. No, it's not. It's terrible. It's insensitive. It's inhumane. It's not a concentration camp. And you really do a disservice to the memory of all the Jews and others who suffered in concentration camps. They should not be used. Maybe you should do a little check of history. Go back to November 9th, 1938. There's a special word for it, Kristallnacht, or Night of the Broken Glass. On that night, the official SA, or the stormtroopers, they went into every Jewish community, and they broke their windows, and they set fire to buildings. And if Jews worked in a place, they were shunned or fired. And that was when it began in earnest. It had been percolating before then, but this is where they pulled out all the stops. So if you had a Jewish business, you now had a Jewish signia across your store. And they started rounding people up. If you were a professional, you no longer could work in a hospital if you were a doctor. Or a lawyer or judge, you were excluded. All professions were excluded. All careers were excluded from the general workforce. And once the roundup started, they didn't have all the concentration camps. Frequently, they didn't have a lot of concentration camps built at that time. So they put them in ghettos, like the Warsaw Ghetto. Imagine a child taken from their home by people who would shoot you and did frequently for no apparent reason. You were deprived of the basics of life. It was horrible conditions to live in the Warsaw ghetto, but then they started taking them from the ghetto and putting them into the concentration camps. Imagine a child is selected by Joseph Mengele. And he had nurses, attendants, he had other doctors working for him. And the child would be experimented upon with no anesthesia. Imagine that you were ripped from your mother's arms, but your mother was taken into a gas chamber. Zyklon B gas was pumped in and she was killed. Her teeth, if she had gold teeth, were removed. Her hair was shorn and the bodies were burned through in the crematorium. Children were worked frequently in factories, and the people who owned those factories, including the Krupp family, were never held accountable. And even with the people like from the Bayer company, the same Bayer company that just bought Monsanto, they were given a slap on the wrist, and only one or two were ever held accountable at Nuremberg. And just imagine working like Anne Frank. She was on the last roundup in the Netherlands, taken to a concentration camp. Had she just not been found out that day, she would have survived, her and her family. Her father survived. She and her sister did not. They died of starvation. And you don't die quickly of starvation. You're given maybe 300 calories a day. And your body breaks down system by system. You're still conscious. Think of the millions of children who died. Think of those who were frozen to death or worked to death or starved to death or just shot. From my personal perspective, when you equate what is happening now with the Holocaust or in concentration camps, you do a disservice to the memory of those who suffered. We can argue and should about separating any child from their parent and putting them in these inhumane cages. They're deplorable. But they're nothing like a concentration camp, which was also called an extermination camp. Get your terminology correct. Oh, I forgot. You're CNN. You're MSNBC. It's all political all the time. We're going to end on a positive note, however. I'm going to play you a short clip, motivational clip about how people are thinking and ways to deal with issues that we don't generally think about. Just a different way of looking at reality. Let's hear it now.
Understand. Are you using your device or is your device using you? Can you put it down? Can you turn it off?
If you don't read the newspaper, you're uninformed. If you do read it, you're misinformed.
So what do you do?
That's a great question. What is the long-term effect of too much information? One of the effects is the need to be first, not even to be true anymore. So what a responsibility you all have to tell the truth. Not just to be first, but to tell the truth. We live in a society now where it's just first. Who cares? Get it out there. We don't care who it hurts. We don't care who we destroy. We don't care if it's true. Just say it. Sell it.
My biggest concern is the unfettered access to social media and cell phones, quite frankly, because there's a biology to these things that are as addictive as alcohol, nicotine, and gambling.
Right now, a family is out to dinner at a restaurant, not enjoying each other's company, but each staring into the screen of their choice, completely ignoring the family members. And this is mom, dad, and the children all doing the same thing while they continue to eat. They did it the entire meal. Right now, an infant is getting their first iPhone and learning to tap and swipe all while drooling on it. 92% of 2-year-olds play video games. because that is what parents are putting in front of their precious children to keep them entertained and quiet.
This is your life now. No natural behavior. Everybody's wearing clothes they don't want to wear. Everybody's showing up and doing something they don't want to do. They have no connection to. That's the problem with our society. And then what's the reward for all this stuff? Go home, get a big TV. Go home, you're going to get a shiny belt buckle. You're going to get a nice purse. You're going to wear shoes that you couldn't afford last week. You're going to get that dream car. And every week we're chasing down this new object. And every week we're trying to fill this hole in this sad shadow of a life that we've been left with after work. That you work 8 to whatever the hours a day plus commuting. And then you're like this. And that's your life. That's your real life. All that other stuff is not your life anymore. All that other stuff is work. And most of us have committed to that. I know you've been there before, and I've been there before. And we understand that it's a trap because we got out of it. But for the people that are in it, a lot of times they don't even understand it's a trap. They just think it's a good job. They think they got dental. I'm doing really good. I got my own parking spot. It's got my name on it. And you're just a piece of a heartless machine that makes money.
All these kids that are graduating college with these $80,000 degrees that can't even work at Starbucks. All the people who put their money in the stock market and bought all this real estate 2008, it all went away. Don't let anybody fool you into believing that there's a guarantee, that there's a safe way. The well-trodden path is the scariest way, in my opinion. Right? Because then you just spent the last 80 years of your life doing everything that everybody else told you to do, and you never really lived or produced anything unique. If everybody's going this way, go that way.
We now know that many of the major social media companies hire individuals called attention engineers who borrow principles from Las Vegas casino gambling, among other places, to try to make these products as addictive as possible.
In South Korea, internet addiction is classified along with alcohol, cigarettes, and gambling as an addiction.
You know, it's about balance. It's not that they're inherently bad, and it's not that texting or social media is inherently bad, but it's when it gets out of balance. If somebody carries their phone wherever they go, like they physically feel anxiety if they put it down, when they're with their friends and have to have it up the entire time looking at the phone while they're with their friends, you know, when they wake up in the morning and check their phone before they say good morning to the person sleeping next to them, these are problems. This is out of balance.
I'm not knocking the phone. What I'm saying is we have to understand, we have to at least ask ourselves, around the world, you here in England, wherever you are, what is it doing to us?
Just some thoughts. Tonight, a very powerful hour. You will not want to miss it. Telling you the truth about what's really going on, and it's going on in the United States also. The abuse of young girls, how officials are complicit, how those who perpetrate are not being held accountable. It's time that we knew the truth. 7 o'clock on PRN.FM. Thank you all for listening and have a nice day.